right, all right, all right. How many of y'all glad to be here tonight? Let's stand to our feet tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor and just give them a handshake or a hug and just tell them you're glad that they're here tonight. Talk to him for a minute.
We cry out to you. it's louder than before. I wanna clap my hands louder than before. I wanna shout a little louder than before. I wanna shout a little louder than before. Let's sing freedom. A little longer than before. I want to clap a little louder than before. I want to praise a little longer than before. I want to shout a little louder than before. To sing freedom. No more bondage, I am free. No more shackles, no more chains. No more bondage, I am free. I said no more shackles, no more chains. No more bondage, I am free. No more shackles, no more chains. No more bondage, I am free. Shackles, no more chains, no more bondage, I am free. We got no more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage, I am free. No more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage, I am free.
Thank you.
your hands and sing it. You're holy. He's holy. You're holy, God. You're holy. You're holy, King Kings. Holy, God.
Yeah,
sing it. He's worthy. He's worthy. Tell him with your own voice, you're worthy. And you're worthy, Jesus. You're worthy. You're worthy, God. There's no one like him, Lord. And you're worthy. Lift it up. And you're worthy. And you're worthy, God. Sing it, holy. Thank you. your hands.
You are holy.
And just begin to sing this to the Lord.
You are holy.
Holy God.
Holy you are. Holy you
are. You are holy, Lord.
And you are holy.
Holy.
You are holy. Holy you are. Holy you are.
Come on, community church, sing it out. Holy.
Holy.
the good things that you've been trying really hard to do. And he says tonight that he wants the highest praise. And his highest praise is when you give him all. When you give him the good and you give him the bad. But all he wants is all of you. To step out. Give him all. That's what he desires. He doesn't turn away. He doesn't walk away when it seems too much.
To him who sits on
Join with heaven tonight. Let your worship rise from your heart.
Oh Lord.
Just sing out in your own song. Let's just let our worship rise in this place. Even a new level, just new levels of breakthrough.
Let's worship just a little bit longer. I believe God's wanting to do something in His presence right now and begin to unleash. And tonight I want you to begin to unleash. I want you to, in your own way, say, Holy Spirit, You have freedom in my life. And for what my say-so is, You have freedom in this place. Just begin to use your gift of divine say-so and begin to welcome in the presence of the Holy Spirit tonight. And say, You are welcomed here, Holy Spirit. Have Your way. We worship You. We worship. We go on. In this atmosphere, I invite you, just breathe in. Do you feel that? Just take a deep breath. Breathe in heaven. Breathe in God's presence. You know, the Bible says that God inhabits the praises of his people. Tells us that where two or more gathered, he's there. Right now, the Holy Spirit is in this place. He's free in this place. And as you breathe in the healing of heaven. Breathe in the goodness of heaven right now. And just let it permeate you right now. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Isn't God's presence refreshing? Thank you, Father. Give him a hand tonight. Thank you, Father. Amen. 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 Well, hug somebody's neck. Let them know. Let them know you're glad you're here. Let them know you're glad they came out tonight. Let them know what's going on in your life. Be a blessing. And I don't know if... how many of you are glad you came out tonight already? Already, you're glad you're here? Wave your hand a little bit if you're real glad you're here. Get a little excited tonight. All right. How many guests do we have here tonight? How many are here from Community Church is not your home church. You're here visiting tonight. Well, welcome, guys. Well, I recognize you, but welcome anyway. Good to have you back. Good to have you guys. Amen. Well, that Sean Smith will bring out some folks on a Monday night. My goodness. He must have the Holy Spirit working with him. You have a little bit of expectancy in your heart tonight? You know, we've seen God do some great things already. Sunday morning, we got to hear about taking a mountain and the promises of God and those that have gone before us and have claimed territory, that it's our time to take it and occupy that. Last night, we got to hear about the zeal of the Lord, that when that zeal, that moment of zeal, that defining moment when we decide to take a stand, when we decide that this is the moment when we will not accept status quo any longer, when we will not accept... we will not accept those things that flaunt itself in the face of God any longer. And our javelin is the javelin of God's goodness. Our javelin is the javelin of his kindness and his mercy. That we take a stand on the goodness of God. Well, I can't wait to hear what tonight is. But before that, we have a chance to sow into this ministry. You know, I just want to ask you, how many of you would say that already the presence of God and the goodness of God is being displayed in this place? Don't you enjoy his worship? Amen. You know, I heard someone say, if that didn't light your fire, your wood's wet. So I hope no one has wet wood out there. I hope it's all good, dry, and ready to flame up. Well, you know, I was thinking about sowing seed, and when we kind of sow seed into a ministry, what happens? And there's a verse that we all know. I remember my youngest son, Nathan, we went skiing with the Comos, and they were there skiing with us. And Victoria Como, a part of our body, told Nathan a verse to memorize, and you know it, Philippians 4:13. I can do what? All things through Christ who strengthens me. And he was skiing down, and he went down he was on a green, and he took a right. And when he took that right, that green turned into a blue. And he went missing for a little while. And I went to go look for him and find him. And, you know, the blind leading the blind isn't always a good thing. So I went looking for him, but I couldn't find him. And finally, I came back down. And here Nathan comes skiing down. We said, Nathan, where'd you go? He said, well, I took a right. And I ended up, I think, on a blue. I said, son, were you scared? He said, yes. But I kept saying, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things. You know, that's true that we can. But you know the context that Paul wrote that in was not ski trips. As much as it is, it wasn't football games. It wasn't overcoming adversity. The context was giving. And in Philippians 4:13, just before that, Paul said, I've learned how to abase and I've learned how to abound. He said, I am content because I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I'm not in need in any way. But then he goes on to say this. I want you to listen, picking up in verse 14. Even though I can do all things that through Christ who strengthens me, he says this, nevertheless, you have done well that you shared in my distress. Now you Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church shared with me concerning giving and receiving, but you only. For even in Thessalonica, you sent aid once and again for my necessities. Not that I seek a gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. Indeed, I have all and abound. I am full, having received from Epaphroditus the thing sent from you, a sweet-smelling aroma, an acceptable sacrifice, well-pleasing to God. And may my God, he shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Now to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. I want you to hear what he said. He said that, not that I need a gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. See, the Philippian church had an account in heaven. There was a full of the abundance of heaven, and actually they were sending up into like the eternal debit card. And as they sowed into Paul's ministry, he said, this seed that you're sowing isn't for me. It's you're sowing it into the kingdom. And I'm so excited, not because my needs are being met because I'm okay, but I'm excited because it's going to abound to you that my God, our God, will supply all your needs according to his abundance, according to his riches and glory. So tonight as we give, I don't want you to think about Sean Smith's needs. He hadn't told me one time what his needs were. He lives in California. I think he's got it made. That's easy street in California. Money falls out of the trees. So we're not giving because Sean Smith needs money. We're not giving just because we appreciate what he does. We're giving because we trust the God that will cause an account in heaven to abound on our behalf. That whatever we need to do, whatever he calls us to do, we'll have every abundant need. Every need will be met with abundance because of his riches and glory. So I want to ask you, when Paul looks at the church in Corinth and says, God loves a cheerful giver, can you imagine why he could say that with integrity? He loves a cheerful giver because givers who understand that they're sowing into a kingdom that will always abound. Return so that we can do everything he's called us to. Ushers, will you come forward? Give them a hand as they come. Right now, I don't know how much exactly we've taken up for Sean over the last two offerings, but I can tell you this. Even though we're not taking it up for the reason of his needs, whatever it is, it's not enough. Not because of his needs, but because I believe in sowing. You know, God's called, his chosen, his people are worth investing in. They're worth honoring. The Bible says, give honor where honor's due. And this is one way we can honor. And I tell you, he has blessed me personally. He has blessed me as a pastor as I've watched him bless you. And if you know that you've been blessed, if you know God has done good things in your life, I don't know how we could do anything else but to sow. Sow to the God of abundance. Wayne, who's praying tonight, Wayne? You praying? You had that look.
Heavenly Father, thank you for making a way for us to be here tonight. And Lord Jesus, your word says that the earth is the Lord's and all that's in it. And so, Father, everything that we have in our pockets and in our purses, everything that we have in our bank accounts and in our investments, it's all yours. And tonight, we're just going to give some of that back to you so you can use it the way you want to. And Father, I pray that when Sean leaves this place, that he will be blessed. In Jesus' name, amen.
In your name, is above all men. Your name is above.
Thank you, Josh. Hadn't Josh and the worship team just been a blessing to us? You know, I just appreciate that God has given us so many gifted and anointed worship leaders, not just musicians, but worship leaders, and able to provoke us to go into God's presence. We've seen a lot of things over the last 2 days, or last day, two services. We've seen some young people have their hearts captured for the kingdom, for the glory of God. We've seen miracles take place. Johnny just came and told me about his grandmother, his stepmom, getting a lung transplant. Hey, Johnny's a little excited about that. Hey, you know what? Sometimes Johnny gets excited and we wonder, what's wrong with Johnny? I'll tell you what's wrong with Johnny. He doesn't mind celebrating. I hope we'll get a little bit of Johnny rubbing off on us. We need to get a little bit excited about what God's doing. If you've had God touch you, if he's released you from some bondage, if you've seen a healing in your life, if you've seen a restoration in some way yesterday through Sean Smith's ministry, you say, God has touched me and changed me in some way. Raise your hand. Look around, Sean. Look around, Sean. As the fruit of your labors, come back and partner with the Holy Spirit some more and labor some more, brother. Isn't that good? Isn't God good?
So encouraging. Appreciate you, brother. You know, John chapter 5, Jesus walks over to a pool at Bethesda. And as he's at this pool, and it says there's a multitude of sick people around. Sometimes I like to read a passage and just, again, place myself in the scripture. Because the pool purported to have healing qualities, that an angel would come down in certain seasons, according to John's account, John 5, angel would come around and stir the waters, and whoever was first in the water, when the water was stirred, was instantaneously healed. This was like, you know, this is like a healing jackpot here. But there's only one problem. If your condition was that you couldn't move quick, this thing wasn't like going to help you at all. So Jesus walks over to a guy that's lame. He's not able to walk. And sometimes I think about this pool as the pool purported to have healing qualities. But if you looked at the crowd around the pool, everyone around the pool was sick. I mean, a pool would seem to be a contradiction to its message. I sometimes think about what the church ought to look like. A New Testament church ought to be a church where people get healed. It ought to be a church where sicknesses and diseases are knocked off your body. And sometimes I wonder if some of our New Testament churches aren't a contradiction to its message, that we acquire folks that consistently sit around that are in direct contradiction to what the Bible says that God does. So Jesus walks over and he goes to one guy and he says, "Do you wish to be made whole?" And it would seem as if that was either an insensitive question or a dumb question, but we know Jesus asked it, so it has to be neither. Amen. Of course I want to be healed. You see me down here, I can't walk. You know, of course, who would not want to be healed? But you know what? I think this is a very important question. I think whenever there's healing meetings, you'd be amazed as to how many people that have taken their identity in their ailment, their affliction, and their sickness to the point where it's subtle. I mean, of course, if you ask them, I think they would tell you, but deep down inside, they kind of like the sympathy they get. They kind of like maybe the disability they get. They kind of like, you know, being able to park in certain places and not have to walk as far, you know? There's certain people that have gotten used to being in a condition. Again, I'm not trying to be insensitive. I'm just saying sometimes there's stuff to work through in order to see people get healed. Jesus is asking a very legit question. Do you wish to be made whole? I think anyone that's going to receive healing has to say by soul searching in their heart, I hate this thing. I don't want to be like this. I'm not okay like this. And again, I understand. And whenever you talk about this, there is a level of sensitivity of people that have lived with stuff. I don't have the answer on that. You know, healing is, and this is what I say, healing is part mystery, part warfare, and all mercy. Okay? Let me say that again. Healing is part mystery. There's a part I'm not going to understand. You're not going to understand. Some people don't want it in their church because they can't figure it out. They can't control it. But what is the alternative? You bind and gag the Holy Ghost and help him to a side room because you're afraid that if the Holy Spirit really took over, it would be out of control. But what I'm telling you is the people's needs are out of control. You need to appeal to a God that has control over their situation and let God be God, right? Makes sense? It's part warfare that you have to contend. That there are times when it's not just a passive thing that I'm just going to sit back and if God wants to heal me, he'll heal me. Again, I understand where that comes from, but hey, there's certain times you got to understand the Bible says submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. So it's not just a submit part, he'll flee. You miss the missing ingredient there. You got to resist the devil. But it's all mercy. It's all appealing. No one earns healing. Jesus Christ died for it on the cross. He gives it as a gift. He goes to a guy and says, "Do you wish to be made whole?" And I love the answer Jesus gets. The answer should have been yes. The guy says, "You know, here I'm lame, and whenever the water's stirred, I'm lame, so I can't move. So somebody beats me to the pool. I have no man to take me to the pool. When the water is stirred, I'm not quick enough to get there. Or if the water isn't being stirred, I'm close to the pool. I move from the pool, but when it is stirred, I don't have a man to pick me up and take me to the pool." He's given all the reasons why he cannot be healed. I think there are people that actually rehearse and meditate in their mind all the reasons why they can't, when in fact they're building a case against God's healing move in their heart, when in fact you should be building a case as to why Jesus is the healer and why Jesus can meet you. We're in a service in San Diego. I'm pointing directly over in this direction. I said, "There's a man that you have a blocked artery." I had no idea what was going on. I just said, "There's a man with a blocked artery." You're a male with a blocked artery. A woman jumps up and runs to the nursery, comes back, brings a baby. There's a baby that has a, a boy, has a blocked artery. Prayed for it, but I said, there's still someone else over there. And then an older guy kind of gives me a little finger up. It's him. He acknowledges. He comes forward. I pray for the guy, and I'll be totally honest. I didn't feel anything. You know, I think sometimes we think healing may happen because I get goosebumps, my hair stands on end. You know, Joshua hit my favorite song and hit a note, and I just felt God and all these things. And sometimes you don't feel a thing, and you get completely healed. I'm praying for this guy. It's like laying hands on a Sears Frigidaire. I mean, it's just like no flow, if you know what I'm talking about. He goes back and sits down, and I'm getting ready to open the Bible and preach, and I point at him, and I said, sir, the Lord says to you, you are healed. I didn't know this guy is scheduled for a double bypass surgery. He has a 90% blocked artery and 100% blocked artery. He was going into the doctor next week to get surgery. He was really low-key in his demeanor. I'd have jumped up like they call my name on The Price is Right, personally. You know, if I, somebody, come on down! You know, I'd have been running, slapping high five all the way. We get the report the next week. This guy goes in to a doctor for his double bypass surgery. They open him up, and guess what? The 90% blocked artery is 100% open. You don't eat, I'm not sure that he did this, but you don't eat McDonald's hamburgers over a period of 50, 60 years and get that white buildup. If you don't believe that, just leave a McDonald's hamburger out all night and just see what surfaces on it. That stuff doesn't go away overnight. How many of you know God had done a miracle? This part, I may lose some people, but this is medically verifiable. Doctor's report. He wrote miracle across this guy's little portfolio. He has a 90% blocked artery. It's 100% open. He goes to the other artery. This is freaky. Can I just say this? He goes to the 100% blocked artery, and it's 100% blocked. But this is crazy. Somehow, I don't know how, I don't know a lot about medicine, but this is what he said. His blood circulation system grew another artery that connected over to the heart that was 100% open. God left one 100% blocked artery, grew another one that connected. The guy has a ministry. He travels around, shares his testimony, and prays for the sick. I don't understand that. I don't get that. I just know that the doctor sold him back up and said, I don't know what to do with you. We're in Todd's hometown. We were in Salt Lake, Utah this year doing a conference. All of a sudden, healings begin to break out. We had the kids, it was a youth and young adults conference. We had the kids pray for the sick. There was one girl that had a bad scoliosis. We called it out through a word of knowledge. Some girls came over and prayed for her. As they were praying for her, her leg grew. She felt her leg grow out. And when her leg grew out, her back grew straight. She's coming up testifying, crying, right? There's another girl that comes up. She had been deaf in her ears. One of the other teenage girls prayed for her deaf ear pop open. She says, I could hear. There's another girl that has eczema, bad skin rash down both of her arms. And she literally, this is the most incredible thing. Healing began at the top of her arms and began to go down. She looks at her arm and she sees the rash disappearing before her eyes as it goes all the way down both arms. You go, I don't know if I believe in that. Well, good thing you weren't praying for her, because the Bible says these signs follow them that believe. You got to believe to see this. Miracles after miracles after miracles. I got a chance in Argentina to pray for a woman that was born blind. I did not have faith for it, so I'm bragging on God. I hope you know that. She comes to me, and through an interpreter, her eyes are like white, milky. She says, because you're from America, I believe that you have a healing ministry. That'll break your heart right there. They think that we're blessed in America because of our standard of living. And I'm looking for someone that has a healing ministry, because at that time, I didn't feel like I had a healing ministry. If you had a runny nose or ringing ears, Brother Smith was your man. I could pray for the ringing to leave your ears and the runny to leave your nose. But outside of that, we need to look for someone else. I was with the Miracle Crusade team, but I was the youngest guy. God gloriously didn't allow anyone else to come. I placed my hands on her, and honestly, I'm praying what I call a tax loophole prayer. That's where you're trying to get out of it, right? Lord, I just pray you'd bless her and give her a safe trip home tonight, God. And I just pray you'd bless her grandbaby right here too. And all of a sudden, this woman, she's in Argentine, she screams, We both didn't need an interpreter for that one. She goes, ah! And I go, oh! I gave the interpretation. She goes, mios, mios, my eyes. She drops, she has a primitive walking cane, she drops it. I had been closing my eyes, but when she screamed, I look in her eyes, she opens her eyes, and as she's closing and open her eyes, I could see pupils, and I'm not exaggerating, pupils and iris form right before my eyes. It freaked me out. I have this Kmart white shirt on and this thin tie. It is extremely hot. I got Lake Erie and Lake Superior going on because it's so hot. She starts moving towards me to give me a hug. I'm so freaked out, I moved away from her. She's scaring me because I'm looking at eyes form right before my eyes. And eventually it dawns on me, she's hugging me and she's saying, you know, in Spanish and the interpreter, she's telling me, she, thank you for giving her sight back. I said, no, I didn't give her sight back. Jesus did this and he's pretty awesome. It's scaring me right now, you know what I mean? I'm in a hotel room in Rosario, Argentina, with my Bible open, looking up at the roof, looking down at the Bible, and I'm going, God, you really do this stuff, huh? I believe that we're entering into a time in America where God is going to take away the luxury of believing in things we don't believe for. We believe in healing, but we need to begin to believe for healing. We believe in deliverance, but we're going to need to believe for someone's deliverance. I believe a new signs and wonders movement is at hand and will be thrusted upon the basic rank and file believer. And we're going to be looking for a pastor or someone else to come, a special speaker. They're not there. And guess who God wants to feature? He wants to feature Christ in you, the hope of glory. The guy is at the pool in John 5, given all these preconditions. And I think sometimes we in our mind, in order for me to get healed, this has to happen, then this has to happen, then this has to happen, then he's got to call my name, then I've got to have this. And Jesus said, in the midst of all of that, little did the guy know that the healer's standing right in front of him. You don't need the pool to be stirred. You need Jesus to move by you and walk by you. And I believe he's doing that right now. I believe he's walking down the aisles, up the rows right now. We're going to pray for the sick. I'm going to still speak on the power of the Holy Spirit. We're going to pray for folks for the baptism of the Holy Ghost and a fresh baptism of power. I've been so stirred about asking God daily for fresh baptism of the Holy Ghost. And I feel like the Lord has put me on this thing. So we're going to pray for baptism of the Holy Spirit. And if you've already been filled, don't check out. Check in. We're going to pray for a fresh baptism. In Acts 2, they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. In Acts 4, they're asking God to fill them again. And so that should tell us something. Right now, I believe Jesus the healer is here. And all it takes is for you to understand that Jesus has done everything he ever needs to do for healing already. It's already done. We think that we still need Jesus to do something, and I understand part of that. What we're saying is we want it to manifest, but what I'm telling you is the price for your healing, the initial move of God necessary for your healing has already taken place. And Jesus, the healer, lives inside of you. John G. Lake often quoted this scripture. He said, the law of the spirit of life has set you free from the law and sin and death. He's basically saying to the people he prayed for, it's already done. And the guy saw Spokane, Washington, become the healthiest city in the United States of America. Saw 50,000 healing miracles in 5 years. I did the math. That's a crazy amount of miracles a day to see that. Right now, if you need healing in your body, whatever it is, if you're able to stand, stand. If you're not able to stand, we will get someone to you. But let me finish John 5. Jesus said to the guy, rise up and walk. It took faith, right? He's not seeing a pool stirred. To him, he doesn't fully know who Jesus is, but I think there was something about Jesus' eyes and presence that inspired faith in his heart, just like what's going on right now. And he said, take up your mat, rise up, be healed, walk. And the guy began to try to act according to what the word of the Lord was. And he rolls up whatever mat he is, and the guy stands up, and all of a sudden he's up, and you could imagine in that moment the incredible miracle. There are many other people at that pool that I would have been lining up. John 5 didn't tell us anybody else lined up. I don't know if it happened, kind of a little background, people weren't paying attention, they're all glued at the pool and looking for the pool, but I think anyone who would have come up to Jesus in John 5 would have gotten healed. So if you need healing, whatever it is, stand up right now. If you need healing in your body, whatever it is, right now, stand up if you need healing. Lift a hand up if you need healing. I want people that are sitting down, you are drafted into the healing army right now. We may have more standing than sitting, and that's okay. We'll work with that. But if you're by someone standing, would you go over and lay a hand on them and let them know? And if no one can come to you, we're going to have you lay hands on yourself. Lester Summerall, a great man of God, a great man of faith, gone to be with the Lord, did some incredible teaching and equipping on healing. He did an informal kind of poll, find out that the least number of people that get healed because a special evangelist prayed for them. The next smallest, and I forget the exact numerical breakdown, the next smallest is friends prayed for you. The largest, and I do remember this, 70% of his informal poll, 70% of the people healed got healed asking God to heal them themselves. So all I'm saying is if no one comes to you and lay hands, you're in the largest category of people that get healed. So don't feel like, oh man, no one got to me, I can't get healed. No, Jesus is here and he's going to be the one to do this, okay? Okay, do me a favor, one-on-one. I know we want to get eight people on one person. Keep your hand up. Everyone sit down. Go one-on-one. Go find someone that has a hand lifted up. Come on. If you want to see a miracle, go find someone. Once someone puts a hand on you, put a hand down. Okay? One-on-one. If we already have two people on one person, one of you leave and go find someone else. Okay? We still got some people hands up. We need some females right here. Come on, some of you young people. Y'all are, I can tell, you got some, right? Okay, now, if you're already with them, begin to ask them, what do you need healing? Ask them, find out what it is. Jesus says you have not because you ask not, or when you ask amiss. You don't ask specifically. Let's ask specific. Ask him what it is. If no one has come to you, lay hands on yourself. And if you're struggling to believe for yourself and no one's come to you, come down front. So we still have a third option. First option, we send someone to pray for you. Second option, you lay hands on yourself in an atmosphere where Jesus the healer is walking down the rows and aisles. Third option, if you're struggling, I totally get that. Come down front and we will make sure we're praying for you. Okay? All right, now ask them what it is. Now, if it is appropriate, place your hand in that area. If it is not appropriate, let them put their hand in that area. And then you put your hand lightly on their forehead, on their shoulder, over their hand. Sweetie, you have such a mighty anointing. Can I borrow you to come over here and pray with these two ladies right here? I'm going to agree with you. Okay, now you begin to pray. I'm going to pray over them as you're praying, but I want you to pray. Now, I want you to know, every single person here that is receiving prayer, remember this. What does it take for your healing? The word of the Lord, and the word of the Lord has already been spoken. A centurion said, Jesus, you don't even need to come to my house. Speak the word, my servant is healed. Jesus said, I've not found such great faith in all of Israel. He says, I'm a man under authority. I'd say to this one, go, he goes, come, he comes. This one, accomplish it, accomplish it. What was the centurion saying? I'm a commander in chief in the natural. Jesus, you're a commander in chief in the spirit. And if you say sickness go, it must go. Healing come, it must come. Holy Spirit, accomplish it, it will accomplish. So let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we declare, we curse every spirit of infirmity. We break every yoke of sickness. We say every symptom of sickness and disease, you must go in the name of Jesus. We lay hands on this region. We speak to bones, joints. We speak healing right now. Lord, from bursitis, tendonitis, rotator cuff injury. We speak to knees, cartilage damage, ankles. We speak to bones, be fused together, be healed. Respiratory problems. We declare bronchitis. We declare pneumonia. We declare asthma healed in the name of Jesus. Every neurological disorder, MS, Parkinson's, any other thing that affects motor skills, we command right now healing to come to the neurological connections. We speak to hearts, blood conditions, blood deficiencies. We speak to immune systems. We bind confusion out of your immune system. We say that immune system will no longer send a signal for the body to attack itself, but the body will bless itself. Come on, keep praying now. We speak to the back. We command that back to be straightened, be made whole. Spinal column, be straightened. Neck, vertebrae, Those that have bulging discs, we command that disc to slide right back into place. Alignment to come to the pelvic of women that have had problems. Somebody, ever since you gave birth, you've had problems with your pelvic or something. Obviously, you're a female. Come on, come on up here. Spirit of the Lord. Spirit of the Lord. Woo! Mary Beth, can I borrow you for a second? Would you place your hand right there upon her hip? I just felt like I got a word. Come on, keep praying. Place your hand right on her. Father, in the name of Jesus, here comes the healing power of the Lord. Father, from the crown of her head, woo, to the soles of her feet, we speak healing right now. Healing. Come on, we say migraines go in the name of Jesus. Deaf ears open. Blind eyes open. 20/20 vision restored in the name of Jesus. Woo. Power of God. We pray supernatural power of God. Flooding God. Whoa. Woo. Woo. Healing power. We bind every tormenting spirit that comes to bring multiple afflictions. Sometimes there's some of you, you could probably have a half a dozen things wrong with you right now. I believe many times that's a tormenting spirit, and we come against it, we see healing. So Lord, we bind every tormenting spirit in the name of Jesus. We cast out a spirit of infirmity. Okay, here's what I want everybody to do. Stay by that person. Everyone praying for someone, including you, if you're praying for yourself, lift your hand up right now. Say this with me. Say, hand, this is the hand of Jesus extended. I am an extension cord plugged into the power plant of God's healing virtue. When this hand comes in contact with sickness, disease, or injury, it must be made whole. My hand is the hand of Jesus right now, extended. Okay, lift that hand up. Lord, receive right now healing virtue in this hand. We activate the anointing for healing right now. We're going to count to three, put our hand back on that person, and we're going to decree be made whole. There's a place to pray for the sick, and there's a place to decree it and declare healing in their body. So come on, we're going to count to three. Now keep your eyes open, and you might want to put a hand on their back just to hold them up, okay? Sometimes the power of God will come and overwhelm folks, so that's the only reason why I say that, okay? So we're going to say, we're going to count to three, and then we're going to put it back in that area. I'm putting it on my left elbow, a little tendonitis. We're going to put it on, and we're going to say, be made whole, loud. We're going to say it loud. It's bold declaration. You ready? Okay, hold it, hold on. Don't put your hand on them yet, okay? We're ready. We're in one accord. Here we go. One, two, three, be made whole. Now leave your hand right there. Leave it there. Whoa. Leave it there, right there. Leave it on that person. Right now, arthritis is leaving somebody's body. Somebody's left knee right now is just being healed right now. I'm getting Abby or Abigail is getting a breakthrough. God's going to put you back on your feet. Who is Abby or Abigail? Where are you at? Where is Abby? Abby or Abigail? Where are you at? Wave. I'm getting this word. Oh, bless your heart. Sweet. Does she have any kind of sickness or any kind of condition? Stomach. Come on up here, sweetie. Come on up here. Now, you probably told me your name, but honestly, I did not remember that. I just was sitting right next to her unknowingly. Felt like the Lord gave me the name. Mary Beth, put your hand right there on her abdominal area. Father, you called her by name. That's special. Jesus, we just pray healing right now for her abdominal area. There'll be no problems, no situation, nothing where maybe she's nausea or maybe food isn't sitting right or any digestive problem. I pray, Jesus, she would feel your warmth and that, Lord, you called her name. A word of knowledge is basically God giving you knowledge that you wouldn't know naturally. And I really didn't know that. If someone asked me, what's your name, I'd look puzzled. Jesus, touch her right now. Amen. Amen. Ooh, come on. Okay, lift your hands up right now. Can you lift both hands up? Is that okay? Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Father, close your eyes. In the name of Jesus, from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet, she's standing in proxy, from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet, Let the anointing of God hit Abby Abigail right now. Here comes the power of God right there. Right there. Whoa, there it is right there. Waves. On three, I just believe that literally as you stand in lieu, you're receiving what she receives. On three, get ready. One, two, three, right there in Jesus' name. Right there, right there, right through her, right through her, right through her, right through her. Okay, here's what you're gonna do. Okay? See if you had a breakthrough. How would you know if you got a breakthrough? Look to see if you have a breakthrough. If you had a back, I would try to bend down by the neck, try to roll a neck. Look for healing though. Look for that lump to disappear, ma'am. Look for that lump to be gone right now. Somebody's praying, there's been a lump. Now, come on. How many of you right now, you just did something. Now, again, some of you got to go to the doctor. Some of you got to give it a week or two or three days. We often get emails later. Oh, man, it never came back. I don't know. But how many of you right now can say, as somebody prayed for me, I pray for myself, I felt healing come in my body, and there's something I know is different. Wave your hand right now. Look at this. Oh, man. Come on, somebody. Give the Lord some praise. Woo! Hallelujah. Now, I would love to take testimonies. We're going to try to take them tomorrow night because I want to give about 20 minutes to preach, and then we're going to pray for a baptism, a fresh baptism of Holy Spirit. And then tomorrow night, you do not want to miss. I don't know. I mean, Todd mentioned something to me. I don't know. We may do a fire tunnel. I don't know if you ever do that tomorrow night. But a commissioning. I got this new message that burns in me on the spirit of Elijah and why I know revival's coming to America. I've had a dealing. So spirit of Elijah, I'm going to talk to you about that tomorrow night. But this is so important. When you pray for the sick, just by way of some teaching, four possible outcomes. Four possible outcomes. And I'm saying this to encourage. You can be seated, by the way. Four possible outcomes when you pray for the sick. Number one, a miraculous, which some of you have identified, a miraculous instantaneous healing. It's a miracle, okay? It's a miracle. Everybody looking at me, right? I know you're going back to your seat. Four possible outcomes when you pray for the sick. Miraculous instantaneous healing on the spot, okay? Some of you got that. Number two, a process of healing begins. Mark 16 says, you'll lay hands on the sick and they shall recover, implies a process. So what some people do is they dig up the seed and disregard it because they didn't get an instantaneous miracle, so they start saying it doesn't work. Many of my healings, I've had more healings of progressive healings in my life than I've had instantaneous on the spot. I've had both, but I've had more. Well, all of a sudden, prayer, I feel warmth, and all of a sudden, man, my shoulder seems to accelerate in the healing process. That's still healing. The initial one is a miracle. This is a process of healing. Jesus is restorative. The anointing is restorative. Number three, right? It gets worse. I'm just curious. Anybody we pray for you, it get worse. Anybody receive prayer and your pain got worse, something just got worse. Come up here. Now, I'm glad that's the case. Oh, not this time. Okay. This time. Reason why I say that is that, watch this. There's no reason why under the anointing, praying for someone to get well, they should get worse outside of one thing. It's a tormenting spirit. I prayed for folks, and the pain leaped from their left over to the right side as you're praying. And you can just see it's a demonic spirit. And 100% of the time, when we bring them up front, when they're in a service, and break a tormenting spirit, they're healed on the spot. So the devil shows himself because there's, again, no reason why you should get worse while we're praying for you in the anointing. Third possible outcome is that, but we see 100% healing on that. Fourth, nothing. You didn't feel anything. Now, here's what I would say. I recognize that's a possibility. I know a lot of evangelists wouldn't tell you that. I just believe in being transparent and honest. But I do believe this. I believe that there are times when it's going to require more prayer and staying in a place of being in the Word and believing. Even Jesus said this type comes out through prayer and fasting. But my picture is this. If we had a big old boulder up here and we lined up 100 strongest men in the world, and they had a big old mallet or whatever, Thor's hammer or whatever it was, and they came and they hit the rock. 99 strong guys, okay, cool, we're going to pray for you. 99 strong guys, you watching me? 99 strong guys hit the rock, and nothing happens. And then we ask Abigail, and she, with a little bit of help, can lift up the rock, drops it, that mallet, on the rock, and it cracks. You guys follow, you get the picture. How many of you know Abigail didn't break the rock? it was the accumulated effect of 99 strong men before her, but her hit was the catalyst, because inside that rock were little fissures that the rock was beginning to break, but you couldn't see it with the natural eye. It took the 100th hit. What I'm saying to you is sometimes it's the accumulated effect of being under the word, under the anointing, and receiving prayer for healing. Come on over here, sweetie. Someone's praying for you and it got worse. Pain got worse. Is that right? Ooh, awesome. I know she's looking at me like I'm strange. What is it, if you don't mind me asking? You have a slip disc in your back and it got worse. Okay, is it okay if I place my hand in your back? I want your permission if that's okay. Okay, you direct me where my hand should be. Right there. Okay, everybody stretch your hands. And what's your name, sweetie?
Shelby.
Shelby, beautiful name. Right here. And you said it's a disc. Did you injure yourself? Okay, and so is the disc, is it like slipping out, or what is it, kind of just crooked, or?
I don't know, I think it's like flipping out.
Okay, flipping out, okay. Shelby, stretch your hands. Father, in the name of Jesus, there's no reason in the world, you give me great faith in these situations. No reason in the world praying for Shelby, it got worse. So we rebuke this pain, we command it to go in the name of Jesus. Come on, stretch your hands forward, folks. Father, we command right now that disc to pop into place. There would be no pinching on any nerves. And we just speak peace right now. I'm placing my hand lightly upon your forehead. Father, there it is right there. On three, just take a deep breath. One, two, three. In Jesus' name. Now, right now, just a peace. Right now, there's a warmth right there in your back. Right there. Can you feel that warmth right there where my hand is at? I totally feel that. Lord, just increase that, Father, right now. Lord, increase it. We rebuke every tormenting spirit. We're not saying it's in you. We just say that the enemy has, for whatever reasons, probably because you're a threat to him, he has tried to target you, but he is defeated. So we rebuke and break every tormenting spirit, every afflicting spirit. Wow, and there's your back just moved. Did you feel that? Yeah, I did too. Your back just shifted. Lord, we bless. Ooh. You stay right here. Keep your hand right here. The power of God is just getting stronger. And you're going to feel like an iron hot right here. What is it over here we're believing for?
It's a few things. It's my back and my ankle.
Back and ankle. 20 surgeries.
I've just started a methadone clinic.
Okay.
I'm 12 days clean now.
Ooh, good for you.
I think maybe that Satan could be coming against me.
Sure. So we're going to break that. What's your name?
Natalie.
Natalie, a beautiful lady, Natalie. Stretch your hands towards Natalie. Close your eyes, Natalie. You're not afraid. You can face me. Okay, if it's okay, I'm going to put my hand right here. You place your hand on her back. Father, ooh, there it is, Natalie. That is the healing anointing right there, even before we begin to pray. We say healing right now. There's surgeries on those ankles and backs right now. We rebuke an afflicting, tormenting spirit. We break its power. And we just declare right now from the crown of her head, woo, to the soles of her feet. Here comes the anointing of God right there from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Breathe in. One, two, three, shoo, right there. Flutter, God. Flutter. Are you feeling that too? Right there? Me too. Whoa. If you can just lift your hands. Father, we declare your love is all over Natalie. Your tangible compassion. You see, Jesus was moved with compassion. You want to pray for the sick. You really got to allow your heart to move with compassion towards people. And I just feel the love of God right all over you right now. Lord's done such a great work in your life. Natalie, such a great work in your life. He has been making a beeline. He's targeted your life. He is literally going to set you up as a testimony as what he will do when someone turns to him and allows God to take control. People are going to look at you and be amazed, Natalie, at the absolute transformation. You're getting heaven's ultimate makeover. It's like them old talk shows where they would show you before and after, and you just go, that's not even the same person. That's what God is doing inside of you. And we just declare, God, we break all condemnation. We break everything off of her that feels like I did something wrong and so I deserve this. We say no in Jesus' name. That's what mercy's all about. And right now, there's healing power that's coming upon you right there. There it is. Receive it in that back right now. All pain, leave. Strengthen her ankles. Strengthen her ankles. You stay right there in that. How are we praying for her? How are we praying for her?
She got worse.
She got worse. Okay, we need to pray. What was it that got worse on you?
My father.
Fibromyalgia. Ooh, I love that. Not fibromyalgia. I love praying for people. My mother-in-law got healed of fibromyalgia. We prayed for her. I didn't know she had it. I called her out. She got it. Father, We curse fibromyalgia right now in the name of Jesus. We come against this thing that causes just, Lord, floating pain throughout her body, particularly in her lower extremities. We speak right now healing virtue to flow and course through her veins. And we, again, break the power of every afflicting spirit, every tormenting spirit. We break your hold, and we just declare the love and compassionate touch of Jesus. And right now, here comes the power of God. Get ready. Lord, right now, Lord, begin to move really up her toes, up her lower extremities, and allow her just begin to feel the peace of Jesus. We say Jehovah Shalom. Shalom to your body. Peace is like, not just peace like the world goes, peace. The peace of Jehovah Shalom is like the condition in the garden before man fell. That's literally the picture of peace. We speak that peace to your body. And Lord, we just declare, and I'm just going to pray this just a sense. Lord, I break the power or any words of rejection that has been spoken over our sister. We break that right now. We declare the answer to all rejection is Christ's loving acceptance. And you love her. You love her, God. And Lord, just move in a little bit more and just kind of begin to embrace her. Father, we just declare just the Lord's loving embrace right now. Shelby, what's going on? What you feeling right now? She says her back feels amazing. It isn't hurting anymore. She says she feels something moving. Woo. You have a mighty touch on your life. You know that, right? Every now and then, it's like I can look on someone's forehead and see M-I-S-S-I-O-N-S, missions. And I just feel like God's got something very special. Shelby, you're on assignment. Stay there. Don't move because God's still got some more for you. Natalie, right? Did you come up here with pain? What are you feeling right now? Totally honest.
It's feeling better,
but there's still some hurt. Okay, I love this. Turn around. I love this. Okay, this is cool tonight. How many of you are okay with tonight? All right? Jesus prayed for a person who was blind. I see, this used to make me nervous before I began to understand that I'd set this perfectionistic standard that just wasn't based in reality. Jesus prayed for a guy who was blind. He said, what do you see? He said, I see men looking like trees. Jesus said, we need to pray a second time. And the fact she got better, some of the pain subsided, that ought to encourage you. So whenever you're praying for someone and they get some improvement, keep praying. Don't stop, right? I mean, why not? I've heard of some guys that have prayed like for crazy miracles and they have prayed 45 minutes with one person an hour. We don't do that in America. But in Africa, they'll pray you through in Africa. Underground Church of China, they will pray you through. Latin America, they will pray till you get your miracle. And we need to get back to it. Now, granted, I know, you know, we look at our watch and everything. Here we go. We want double agreement. Let me get another woman of God to come up here as well. And we're going to put both hands on her back right now. We're getting double. One could put 1,000, two could put 10,000. Stretch your hands towards her. Everyone in the building. Natalie, you got everyone in the building praying for you. No pressure. Father, in the name of Jesus, some of the pain left. We want all of the pain to go. We want it to go down to zero, no pain. So, Father, you touch Peter's mother-in-law and fever left her as if fever was an entity. We rebuke pain as if it's an entity. We command it to go right now in the name of Jesus. And we just, ooh, man, I just felt the anointing of God right there. And, Lord, we just declare that pain subsides. It goes, it goes, it goes, it goes. And, Lord, I just declare too, Lord, I just see something. Lord, I pray you would lengthen her leg, and I pray her pelvic, I think there's been some compensation, her pelvic, her hip would begin to shift right now in Jesus' name. Watch, something's going to begin to happen right now. In the name of Jesus, we command it right now to begin to shift and her leg to be lengthened and grow right now. Right now, in the name of Jesus. I know some people sit folks down and do that, and I don't have a problem doing that, but I just feel like something's shifting. Yes. Lord, right now. Now, here it is. Lord Jesus, we say right now, be released over her entire body. Lord, every part of her back, every disc, every vertebrae, spine column, all of it, her ankle, no pain. Pain leaves her body. Lord, right now. Now just take a deep breath and breathe in. As Pastor said, heaven right there. Now, Jesus, touch. You can breathe out now. There's a peace right there. Peace right there. Wow, I just felt that right there. Right there. Just stay right there for a moment longer. You stay right there. How are you doing? Well, I missed that. I'm sorry. She thinks she can stand up. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Hey. It doesn't hurt. Come on, somebody. She says it doesn't hurt. Woo! Father, we just declare right now, in the name of Jesus, hallelujah. I'm going to have a strange request for you. I just want you to take 3 steps, and on that third step, just close your eyes and just hold tight right there. I just feel like something about taking 3 steps from where you're at. You ready? Okay, ready. 1, 2, 3. Now stop right there and just hold tight. There it is. Holy Spirit, flutter right there. In Jesus' name, we release his presence right there. We release his presence right there. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, thank you, Father. Jesus' name. Ooh, man. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we break off every curse. We know that she's a child of God. And so, like I was talking last night, I believe the blood of Jesus. But there's certain times where there's a specific thing that's aimed at someone. And it's just good to just in prayer enforce what the cross has already done. So we break that curse and we plead the blood of Jesus over Natalie. And we say right now the blood covers all of that stuff. And we just declare she is blessed. And God, you took a curse upon you that the blessings of Abraham would be upon us. And God, we even got greater blessings because there was blood of bulls and goats and whatever in the Old Testament. But now we have the precious blood of the Lamb. And we say you are blessed right now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. All right, just come on. How are you feeling right now?
It feels much better.
Much better. Yes. Come on, much better. She's smiling and saying that. Awesome. You guys can be seated. Thanks so much. Awesome. End of the service. There's still some more for you. All right. Woo! Are you guys okay? Now, could you give me 20 minutes? Are you able to do that? Okay. Open up your Bibles to Acts chapter 8. You can give me 20 minutes. That's all I need. We've got stuff out there. We've got our second book out there. We sold out of our newest. We still have some of our first book, Prophetic Evangelism. Second book, Epic Lifestyle. People will say, what's that about? Epic is an acronym, Evangelism and Prophecy Invading Culture. So this is Prophetic Evangelism 2. But I was advised you never name a book after the name of a book you had before it. So you can do movies like that, but you don't do books like that. So this is next level prophetic evangelism, and it comes with a DVD of what I call spiritual coaching for marketplace miracle ministry. My job as an Ephesians 4 evangelist is to equip you to walk in it. So we got that out there, and then we've got a teaching and stuff on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So 20 minutes. All right, here we go. You can set your watches. I'm sure about this, and wherever Joshua is at, you just come up in 15 minutes, Joshua. Awesome, bro, wherever he's at. Acts 8:1. Now Saul was consenting to his death, and at that time a great persecution arose against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea, Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. Stephen had been stoned by the consent of a Saul of Tarsus, who would eventually become Apostle Paul. Verse 3, as for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering every house, dragging off men and women, committing them to prison. 4, therefore, those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word. Then Philip went down in the city of Samaria, preached Christ to them, and the multitudes with one accord heeded the things spoken by Philip, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying out with a loud voice, came out of many who were possessed, and many were paralyzed and lame were healed. Let me say that again. For unclean spirits crying with a loud voice came out of many were possessed, many were paralyzed and lame were healed, and there was great joy in that city. But there was a certain man called Simon who previously practiced sorcery in the city, astonished the people of Samaria, claiming that he was someone great, to whom they all gave heed from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God. And they heeded him because he had astonished them with his sorceries for a long time. But when they believed Philip, as he preached the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, both men and women were baptized. Then Simon himself also believed, and he was baptized and continued with Philip and amazed, seeing the miracles and the signs which were done. Jesus, we thank you. We know if the service were to end tonight, it was an awesome night. But Lord, we are not done. We're not through. And Lord, we know that you've got more that you want to do. So Lord, we bless you and we thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. 2 Timothy chapter 3 tells us about what's going to happen in the end times. And it says that essentially in the end times, it says perilous times will come. That word perilous means times that would be hard to take. The word there means times that would take your breath away, times that are grievous. The Greek New Testament only uses the word for perilous. Somebody say perilous times. In the last days, say it with me, in the last days, there would be perilous times. That word for perilous is only used one other time in the Greek New Testament. It's used to describe the demon-possessed men of the Gadarenes. It's Paul's way of describing that the last days would appear demonized. Then it goes on to list. Men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, brutal, despising, haters of good, unforgiving, unloving, irreconcilable. And it goes on and on and on. And the interesting part is these aren't describing people of the world, right? They have always been people in the world like that. This shouldn't surprise us. But he's saying there are going to be people with these qualities that claim, if you will, to be Christian. That's why he would later say, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. So the shocking part is there'd be people who would try to say they are followers of Christ, but this is the behind-the-scenes activity. Interesting preaching point, but because we only have 20 minutes, I can't go there. Goes on to say, it says, although they have a form of godliness, they will deny the power thereof. The word deny has two meanings, okay? I don't go to the original very often, but when I do, it's really because I'm trying to make a point, so stick with me. The word deny, the word power, is a word, a derivative of the word dunamis, or dynamite, explosive, miracle-working power. Acts 1:8, after the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you shall receive power. The word there is dunamis. So 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 8, is a form of the word dunamis. So he's saying, in the last days, there are going to be people that are going to deny the supernatural power of God, which is part of the reason why they only have a form of godliness, because if they receive the power, they would actually have the power to walk in not just the form, but they would have the authentic, real deal McCoy. The word deny means to refuse what is being offered. Paul is prophesying that in a day where people need power, people are going to refuse the true power of God. And I thought about this in the West. How many of you know we're in the Western world? I believe that we are ripe for a spiritual revolution. We are ripe, but it's going to require that we see something, an opportunity. Because I believe that because we are spiritually and morally bankrupt, we are a nation that is scientifically and materialistically so in overdrive, it has failed to meet our needs. In other words, we have such a scientific and materialistic worldview that has failed to meet our deepest needs, that what we've done is that we have a nation that is giving themselves to the occult, giving themselves to Wiccan, giving themselves to New Age, giving themselves to their own psychic abilities and power, which is demonic for all intents and purposes. It's witchcraft is what it is. And even though that we are technologically overdeveloped, we're spiritually and emotionally underdeveloped. And I believe that this is causing in America a vacuum that will not remain a vacuum for very long. There's a phrase, nature abhors a vacuum. We are going to have a spiritual revolution, much like the 1960s when the Beatles brought over the Eastern mysticism of the Maharaji and they put the Beast, Aleister Crowley, on one of their early albums. And an entire generation practically began to move towards the Eastern occult until God, and I love this, one of the Beatles, John Lennon, said in 1967, he says, we're more popular than Christianity. Jesus Christ essentially will go, and we're more popular. And a year to the date after that, in San Francisco and Hayden Ashbury, a guy by the name of Ted Wise was literally a acid freak, get saved, baptized in the Holy Ghost, and they would cite that was the beginning of the Jesus People movement. 1 year after a guy in the Beatles said, we're more popular than God, God literally, by 1972, put the Jesus Revolution on the cover of Time magazine as 85,000 gathered in your state at the 72 Expo of literally all these hippies out there that had now given their life to Jesus Christ. They would preach the gospel and pray people through to the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And I'm telling you, what happened in the 60s, and I feel like I got a word on this, in terms of the vacuum of spirituality, the lack of answers coming from an establishment as a generation is seeing it, I believe that they are hungry for and desperate for a deeper level of encounter and power. And I believe it's now that we cannot deny the power thereof. And why do you say that, Sean? Because I believe that there are churches in America that believe if we could just get a better program, and their programs are in their own mind putting enough bodies in seats, and they don't realize that their programs will ultimately fail the folks because the devil isn't shooting paper mache arrows at them when they walk outside. He's coming at them, and if you don't have enough spiritual weaponry and understanding, if there isn't enough anointing on the word, you need to thank God that you're at a church that preaches the word and doesn't give you opinions and sound bites and Reader Digest little storyettes to make you Christianettes. Go home and suck your butt on your bassinets. Come on, somebody. The devil is afraid of a pulpit that's bringing the full gospel. The Bible tells us that people are going to deny the power. But here is the other shade of the meaning. Two shades of the meaning: deny. Deny the power. Deny the supernatural, dunamis power of God. First one is to refuse what is being offered. The second one, it means to act entirely unlike. Paul is prophesying that there will be a group of people that will act entirely unlike they've received the power of God. So to me, would imply maybe they've received it, or maybe they were in a position to receive it, but they act like they've never got it. And I wonder how many, I want to be positive, okay? Everybody smile at me first. We need a smile break. The greatest need for the Spirit-filled movement is to get Spirit-filled again. We say we're full gospel. We say we're filled with the Holy Spirit. And my thing is, we look across the landscape of America churches that say we're full of the Spirit. And my thing is, where is the evidence? Because when I look at the book of Acts, the evidence is a community gets changed. We have people saying they're having moves of God. And my thing is, has the crime rate changed in your city? I'm not denying that you got a move of God, but you better be pressing in for something more. God wants to give you more. If it isn't leaving the building, it is not yet a full-fledged move of God. I got 10 minutes, so let me set it up. I love this. God is about taking cities. Rochester, New York, 1830. A lawyer that went out in the woods that met God and got baptized in the Holy Ghost, Charles Finney, considered one of the greatest American revivalists and evangelists. How many of you heard of Charles Finney? Charles Finney was a lawyer, went out and met God. He was baptized in the Holy Ghost, wrote in his own book. He said, unutterable gushings begin to bellow out of my soul. Huh. Sound like he must have got a prayer language to me. Okay, I don't want to read in between the lines, but unutterable gushings begin to bellow out of my soul. I think I had that experience too. The guy goes to Rochester. It's a godless place. Prostitution, crime. In the time that he is there in Rochester, New York, some people say to this date, it was the greatest revival in one city ever. They said the entire city got saved. That may blow some folks away. During the time he's there, a year he's there, 1830, to 1831. The population of Rochester, New York grew by 2/3, but crime decreased by 2/3. Wow. Is that something? They said bars were empty and jails were empty and parishes and churches were filled. Prostitutes quit prostituting and they form intercessory groups. Come on, somebody. One day you went out there and the sister going, hey, hey. Next day she's going, oop-a-ba-ta-ta-ra-ma. So Lord Jesus, we just pray. Come on, somebody. Oh. Jonah went into Nineveh. They're skinning people alive. They're stacking the heads of their antagonists of other nations. They stack their heads on the ground. He goes in, entire city gets saved, right? And it's Samaria. It is pretty close to an entire city reaching a tipping point. Let me just say this. God is into reaching cities. God, as far as that may seem for the way we're looking at our cities today, I believe that all it takes is for one city. Come on. And Joshua, wherever you at. All I believe is it takes for one city to tip, and it's going to be like Roger Bannister breaking. What did he break? The 4-minute mile, right? People didn't believe you could run a mile in 4 minutes or something. The dude did it, and the following year, dozens of people broke it once he broke it. I believe that all it takes is for one city. Orange, Texas gets a breakthrough. There's going to be all kind of other cities across America that believe if they can get a breakthrough. It's like we're waiting for a Roger Bannister church. We're waiting for the Lord to pour out the Holy Ghost over his banister, and we could be like a spiritual Roger Bannister. And all it takes is one city, and all of a sudden, someone's going to begin to believe. If it can happen in that city, God, we want it to happen in our city. But I believe that God will raise up a forerunner people that believes that it can happen because it's happened before. Now, let me set this up in about the 7 minutes I got left. Samaria is given over to witchcraft, right? They got a dude named Simon the Sorcerer. Everybody thinks he's the power of God. In other words, get this. They say he's the great power of God. What is the great power of God? The Holy Spirit. He is trying to fill the void of the lack of the Holy Spirit in a city. I believe across America, our I would say fascination with the occult is more of a default that people are driving past our churches and going to psychic houses because they think they're more power in the psychic house than they think it is in our Holy Ghost services. And it's because we need to export the power out the building. All of a sudden, God wants to take a city. What does he do? He sends Philip. Now, let me explain something. There is Philip the apostle. He was one of the 12 disciples. He is now an apostle. That's not the Philip that goes down to Samaria. There were 7 deacons. Their job was to wait on widows, and they had a food distribution. The widows, they would take orders from the widows and write down what food they needed, and the guys, I presume, I don't know if they had like a lot of churches, they had a food pantry or whatever, they would go and they would get the food and they would bring it and meet the widows' needs depending on their food needs, and I'm sure there were other needs they met as well. So one day, you just got a picture, one day, Philip is, okay, let me get this. You need some milk, you need some eggs, you need some Ajax, you can clean your sink, you need, you know, he's taking food orders and he's going to go, right? One day he's doing this. Let me just say something. You don't realize that in one day you could be doing something that's seemingly totally unrelated to the spiritual exploit you're about to unleash the next day. One day he's taking orders from widows, the next day he's taking cities from devils. Come on, somebody. You have no idea. You may be working a 9-to-5. You may just be a student. You may just think you're a housewife or a house husband. But let me tell you what. God pours his spirit on you. You don't know what kind of damage, what kind of healing ministry, what kind of, man, salvations and massive number are going to come to know the Lord because of your obedience. One step. The guy in the midst of persecution, he's going through some rough stuff. But in his rough stuff, he doesn't know. God is using it to direct him towards where he wants to. So he goes to Samaria, and he begins to preach Christ. As he preaches Christ, miracles start happening. And I start thinking about what happens if Philip doesn't go to Samaria. Think about this, okay? Okay, we're in our final 4 minutes now. Final four, here we go. It says, therefore, those who were scattered went everywhere. Philip went down in the city of Samaria, preached Christ to them. Multitudes with one accord heeded things spoken by Philip, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. Unclean spirits crying out with a loud voice came out of many who were possessed. They say, what happens if you backmask a country western record? Your Chevy truck comes back to you. Your runaway dog comes back to you. Your old girlfriend comes back to you. Because you play it front ways. They singing about their truck, their girlfriend, their dog, right? Let's play this backwards. If Philip doesn't go, then there's not joy in the city, right? Because he preached Christ, there was joy. So if there's not joy in the city, it means there's depression. He don't go, depression stays in place over a city. It says unclean spirits came out. Okay, stop. Philip doesn't go and preach Christ. That means people who are walking in purity are bound by impurity. Unclean spirits stay in the place. and perversion reigns in a community because the people didn't go. Philip doesn't go. It says that they were healings, and people that were healed are now able to walk or jump or paralyzed and lame. So that means people that would remain in a place where they were immovable, they weren't having progress with physical conditions, maybe even with dreams and things in life, they would stay in that place if Philip doesn't go. It goes on, or it says there that the multitude with one accord gave heed to the things spoken. That means the multitude doesn't hear if he doesn't go. A lot is on the line on simple obedience of a glorified drink waiter. The guy's taking drinks and orders of food from widows, but he's going out of obedience. Simon the sorcerer. See, the devil thinks that if he goes witchcraft, the highest shelf the devil can pull from is called divination. It's witchcraft. But God has a shelf way higher than that. It's called dunamis, dynamite explosive miracle working power. And when the world goes divination, God's people must go dunamis, baptism of the Holy Ghost. Philip preaches, the city leaves. So it's like this crowd, you know, I don't know if you remember in the original Toy Story, they go, the claw, he's our leader. You know, they're walking around, Simon, he's our leader. And all of a sudden they see the miracles of what Philip is doing. And they all of a sudden break out of his trance. He really had a bewitching effect on them. He had astonished them. It means to displace. It means to bewitch them. It was a spirit of witchcraft. All of a sudden, their eyes are open, and they begin to confess, give their life to the Lord. They're getting baptized. And all of a sudden, Philip somehow gets word, or word somehow gets to Jerusalem. Peter and John come down. They begin to pray for him, so they begin to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And there's obviously some evidence, because Simon, who is a hardened witchcraft guy, begins to offer money. They said that he believed. He began to offer money. Say, what? How much does it cost? But give me the power so that, man, when I, man, put my hands on people, man, I can get to see the same thing. I believe that, man, you're going to walk in something that witches going to wish they had. Okay, I'm going to need to get your permission. I need 5 more minutes. How many of you give me 5 more minutes? My son and a group of another spiritual son, my son Brandon, they're at an asparagus festival in Stockton. And at the festival, they get permission every year to go out there. They're a ministry of college students. They go out there, and what they do is anybody that comes to the booth, they pray over them, and they ask God to speak over them prophetic words. And they've got different names for it. People can get funny about that, and I know they can get all legalistic. Well, you can't do that. You can't do that. They call it spiritual readings, right? But they say spiritual readings from God, right? Makes sense. Down the way is a psychic dude. All of a sudden, all these kids are coming over to their booth. Brandon and all these students are praying. Girl gets healed. They all of a sudden, they get a word of knowledge. They say, you've been in an accident. You got pain in your neck. She goes, I did. She said to another one, you're a leader. And all her three friends, that's so right. She is our leader. You know what I mean? Like everything the guys are saying. They prayed for these girls. All four of them get healed. They all give their life to Jesus Christ. They go back out in this festival, because it's an area-wide asparagus festival. They make asparagus ice cream, asparagus bread, asparagus smoothie, asparagus syrup is nasty, okay? They're going out and getting everybody. All of a sudden, nobody's down at the psychic dude's booth. Guess what happened? The psychic booth dude leaves his booth and comes down to them and asks, can I get a spiritual reading from God? When you operate in dunamis, it deactivates divination. Witchcraft can only operate if we don't get filled and operate in the fullness of spirit. Now, Acts chapter 2, Jesus told 120. We at least by the end of 10 days, we know 120. He might have told as many as 500. 120. He tells his church, the disciples, he tells them, go to the upper room until you receive power, until you receive dunamis. And he says, then you're ready to go out and be sent out. Because it's as if Jesus knew everything they were going to come against, and he knew they needed to be empowered. I know that we have an affinity in America for superhero movies, superheroes that have powers. But I think it's because it's in our DNA to see someone operate in power. But I'm telling you, there's no greater power than the power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. There's no greater power. The Hulk can't do that. Come on, somebody. I think Samson would give the Hulk a run for his money if you know, as long as Samson's hair wouldn't cut, you know. They're in the upper room, and by the 10th day, I don't know what it looks like, but somehow I believe the laser beam of light pierces the eastern, western sky. They come down, psh, All of a sudden, I love what Winky Prackney says. That day, everybody got to be birthday candles on their church's first birthday. Flame came and sat on each of their heads. Thus, the term they look like. And they began to speak in other tongues. I don't know why people have problems with speaking in tongues. We have psychics. This lady, Sylvia Brown, will get on Montel, and she'll be talking to dead relatives, and she'll mumble something. And I've seen another one get on there with some sort of Babylonian chant, and believes that she channels a 35,000-year-old spirit called Ramtha. And I'm thinking, the devil cannot create, he can only counterfeit. So you're telling me a God that created the world, that is the ultimate in omniscience, wisdom, that he couldn't have a language you don't understand and yet still profit you by speaking that language? If I were to speak straight Swahili right now, some of y'all would look at me funny, right? Like, you know, when you blow a dog whistle, a dog turns head, or, you know, you would look at me funny. Why? Because it's not your frame of reference. But if we take you over to Africa, maybe a certain place, and you speak English, they're looking at you funny. Languages are all about frame of reference. See, I just think people don't know the why behind the what. The why behind the what is, the Bible says you speak in tongues. You don't speak to men. It's not a horizontal gift. It's a vertical gift. And the Bible says that your mind is unfruitful. So when you say you don't understand it, it's biblical. God's already telling you. You're not supposed to understand it. But he understands it. And here is the power of it. Number one, it says it edifies you. If your car battery dies, we got to get someone with a good battery, get jumper cables out, jumpstart your battery. It could be said we're edifying your battery. When you pray in tongues, you get baptized in the Holy Ghost, God takes the jumper cables of heaven and pushes it on your spirit. That's why depression can't stay on a person that utilizes their prayer language. That's what Jack Hayford said. Take it from a guy that really knows and studies. He prayed. David Young E. Cho says something supernatural happens if you pray in the spirit 1 hour a day. I heard this. I got saved. I saw all these students on my campus ministry. All these kids are baptized in the Holy Ghost. And someone said, did you think it was of the devil? Well, no, because they witness more than anyone I see witness. They worship God the way I've never seen anyone worship God. They loved on each other. And I'm going, man, I'm telling you what, I want that. And I began to look in the Bible. I saw it in Acts 2. I saw it in Acts 8. We're in Acts 8. Acts 9, Acts 10, Acts 19, 1 Corinthians 12, 1 Corinthians 13, 1 Corinthians 14, Ephesians chapter 5. I saw it in the book of Jude. I saw it back in Isaiah through stammering lips and foreign tongue. I will speak to a people. And I began to realize this is all over the Bible. God smote folks' tongues in the Tower of Babel because they thought they could build a structure in the heaven. And I'm just going to take God's word on it. He says they become one. Now, nothing will be impossible for them. I don't understand how they could go into a spiritual realm through a physical building, but I'm just going to take God's word. He smote their tongue. Everybody spoke different languages, so there was no unity. So Acts 2 is the reverse of Babel, to bring the church in unity so they could build his eternal structure, the church that could release his redemptive kingdom in the earth. And then we got people that struggle with a language? Come on. There's over 110,000 languages in the world. I once heard someone say that. Does anyone here know all the languages? No. So how do you know that maybe the language God gives you isn't a language of the world? But there is tongues of men, tongues of angels. This is my point. There's some things, when it's all said and done, you don't wrap your mind around. You see it in the Word of God. You let your heart absorb. Because anyone that says, let me say this, okay, now I'm in overtime. God created, by breathing in dirt, a man, pulls a rib out the man, makes his wife. They are the mother and father of all civilization. They bit a fruit. Because they bit the fruit, mankind bit the dust. Sin has entered into the equation. There's a serpent already in the garden by a snake, who is Satan, who is an angel, who is an archangel Lucifer, kicked out of heaven, in charge of worship. He's got instruments built inside of him. He said he was going to be God. Comes down to earth, jealous of the relationship that man, God has with man. He deceives them, tells them they're like God, even though they were already like God. But if you eat this fruit, you'd be like God, which is dumb. And that's what the devil's already tempted you with, something you already got for the most part. And all of a sudden, God begins to try to build a lineage that he could bring his son. And we see, you know, different things happening, you know, rocks taking out giants, walls falling down, jawbone of a donkey wiping out armies. You see all these things. And then all of a sudden, a young girl named Mary, she's a virgin, she has a baby, but she's impregnated by the Holy Ghost. She gives birth to the Son of God, the Eternal One. He grows, he does miracles, dies on the cross, gets up out of the tomb. And if you believe in that, you're going to heaven. How many of you believe that? Now, here's what I'm going to say. That's a bit far-fetched, okay? I'm not trying to talk you out of believing, but I'm saying You can't figure that out. Why are you going to start trying to get cerebral on us now and figure out Acts chapter 2 when everything I just told you, that's a little out there. We're going to have to believe. It's called faith is what I'm saying. It takes faith. You don't get there intellectually. Everything comes by faith. So if you didn't get into the kingdom by using the cerebral cortex, gray matter, your brain, I'm going to tell you something greater than your brain is your heart. We only use 5% of that according to a Russian study anyway. So here's what happens. Right now, we're going to pray for people for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. If I can get all the prayer team, anyone that Pastor Daniel would bless that's used to praying for people for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, because I went overtime. We can get all of you to stand up. Husband and wife, you're on a prayer team. I saw a bunch of you Sunday morning, so we have you. We need all hands on deck. All hands on deck, okay? We'll get you up here. Todd, you come up here for a while. I don't know if later on you'll have to run, take care of some things. But if we can get you to all come up. I believe that if you're here right now, you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, you're about to be filled. And tomorrow night, let me just say this because I may not be able to say this again. Tomorrow night, you want to get everyone here possible. I believe tomorrow night is going to be another massive night of salvation. I believe it's going to be a massive, massive night of a baptism of fire and just a commissioning. But I want everybody now out there, close your eyes for a second. Heads bowed and eyes closed. If you're here now, you don't know Jesus, you're disconnected from authentic power, real power. The power that answers the deepest cry of your heart. The power to conquer sin. People have power to do things. You may have a power to get a vote. You may have power to make an idea happen. You may have power. But the power to get your sins forgiven lies in one and one alone. The power to bestow eternal life lies in one and one alone. And here is the thing about what the devil does. The devil wants to give you hell to go to hell on. He wants to make your life so miserable. Why? Because he's jealous of you, because you can do something the devil can't do tonight. You can repent. The devil can't repent. His destiny's fixed. So he's jealous that you could, in right now, in this moment, receive the invitation from Christ. It begins with God. We have the power to make a decision. But do not make a mistake. It begins with God. God is extending an invitation to you, friend. And if you don't know God, this invitation begins with you turning over the steering wheel of your life to eternal loving God. Jesus loves you. He died on the cross. He was saying, essentially, I'd rather go to hell for you than to go to heaven without you. You don't slap that hand back. You grab onto that hand and allow him to lift you. He says, the Bible describes taking you out of the miry clay and putting your feet upon a solid rock. You begin to feel stability, and you begin to feel certainty in the midst of a world of uncertainties. You begin to know your sins are forgiven. You begin to know that you have a supernatural big brother and God who will always have your back. You begin to know that heaven's your home. These things are big question marks, and God wants to turn the question mark into an exclamation mark, where you know this is true, emphatic. I know in whom I believe. If you're here right now, you say, Sean, pray with me. I need to give my life to Christ, or I need to come back to Jesus. If that's you, wherever you're at right now, slip your hand up right now. Slip it up wherever you're at right now. Say, Sean, I need Jesus, or I need to come back to the Lord. Anybody like that tonight? God bless you. God bless you. Yes, yes. See, about three hands. Anybody else? Say, I need to surrender my life to Christ. Let's pray. If you lifted your hand, would you just stand up right where you're at? Right where you're at. I'm not going to call you down here tonight. I may do that tomorrow night. But tonight, I want you to stand right where you're at, and we're going to pray. Stand up if you lifted your hand. Don't be shy. Don't be ashamed. This is celebratory right here. This is about you responding to Christ. Okay? Let's all pray this together. Say this with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I confess you as Lord of my life. I declare tonight, you are my Savior, and I make room for the King and His kingdom in my heart. Lord, I repent. I turn over the steering wheel of my life to you, and I ask for forgiveness for doing it on my own. I now know I can't do it on my own. I need you. I thank you, Jesus, that you value me. You love me. You have forgiven me. You've died and resurrected for me. And I declare today, I'm a child of God with a new heart, new desires, new power. All addictions, obsessions, and iniquities are rendered helpless as the anointing and grace to deny ungodliness is awakened in me. And I declare, God, I'm serving you all my days in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, somebody give the Lord a mighty clap. Hallelujah. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, the most significant time, please come down. Everybody else bow their heads real quick. If you're here right now, you say, Sean, I have not been baptized in the Holy Ghost. I do not have released in me a heavenly language, a prayer language. I believe one of the evidences is that God enables you to praise him in a heavenly language, another tongue that he gives you. But I believe there are many evidences of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But that is one of the immediately, you know, verifiable that I always encourage people. Believe for that, because there are other gifts of the Spirit. All kind of, you hear God's voice more clearly. You're given greater boldness. Your heart begins to feel a greater empowerment to go with God. You begin to walk in signs and wonders. Man, heaven begins to open up to you. I'm telling you what, you begin to get a passion for witnessing. All these things and many, many others are evidence with everyone that's ever received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You can read the book of Acts and see it's true. That gift is for you. But more than anything, let me tell you, 2 Timothy chapter 3, I didn't finish it all till right now. In the last part of that verse, it says, as Jannes and Jambres resisted Moses, so will these resist the truth, men of corrupt minds. It says, but their progress, they will progress no further, and their folly will be evident to all. Jannes and Jambres were the Egyptian magicians in Pharaoh's court that opposed Moses. How did they oppose Moses? Because however they opposed Moses, Paul is prophesying that's how you're going to be opposed as people of the truth in the last days. Jannes and Jambres did not oppose them through debate, did not oppose them through economic sanctions, did not oppose them through legislature and voting. They opposed them supernaturally. In the last days, there is going to be supernatural opposition. You must walk in supernatural power. And if you will, it says that you're going to showcase something that will cause them to look, in a sense, like they have failed. It's folly. They will be exposed if you walk in. And this is what Philip did to Samaria and took over a city. And I believe this is what it's going to take for us. If you're here now and you say, I've not received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, but I want this power, want this intimacy. And it's really about becoming more intimate with Jesus. It is about impact, but it begins with an encounter with Jesus, the Holy Spirit, in such a way that your heart goes to a whole nother level in revelation and knowing who God is. If that's you and you say, Sean, I need the baptism of the Holy Spirit, wherever you're at right now, stand up on your feet right now. If you say, I need the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I've not had releasing me a heavenly language, but I need the baptism. I want to be filled with the Holy Ghost and power. If that's you, stand up right now. Don't be shy. Okay? I want all of those who are standing, come stand in front of a person you'd feel comfortable with praying you through. And if someone is already taken, just go to the next person. But hold tight before they pray. We're going to pray corporately, and then you're going to be released to pray over them individually. So keep coming down. Group two, okay? You say, I have been baptized in the Holy Ghost, but you know what? I need to be filled with the Holy Spirit afresh, because I have seen that I've allowed some fears. I've allowed, man, just some comfort, convenience to become like demonic walls of containment. I've become afraid to witness. I've become afraid to step out of my comfort. I need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. I'm under warfare. I'm under attack. I need to be refilled. If that's you, stand up on your feet right now. If you're saying, I need to be filled, a fresh baptism of the Holy Ghost. I want you to step out of your seat. You to come down in front of someone that's available. And then group three, you say, and I might have already said it in group two, but let me say group three, you're saying, I want boldness to be a greater witness, to step out in signs and wonders and sharing the gospel. If you're group three, you stand up and you come down as well and just line up behind. And tomorrow night, we're going to pray. We're going to have a salvation thought, and we're going to have a baptism of fire tomorrow night. So tonight's not the only night. Okay, I want everybody to look at me just for a second. I'm going to give a brief instruction, and we're going to pray, and folks are going to get filled. Okay, here's a brief instruction. We're going to pray together asking Jesus to baptize us in the Holy Ghost. We can baptize you in water. Jesus reserves the right himself to baptize you in the Holy Ghost. John 7:37. If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Come to me, Jesus said, and drink. out of the innermost being shall flow rivers of living water. You come to Jesus, but you have to drink. You're going to have to give up that inner control freak. Ever since we're little kids, we're raised to be in control. People that like to be in control struggle right now. Yield control. In fact, in your own words, say, Holy Spirit, I yield control. I yield my body. That's why the tongue is so important, I think. Because James says, whoever controls the tongue can control the whole body. It's a rudder on a ship. That's why the Holy Spirit makes a beeline for your tongue. If you think, why tongues? It's because it directs your entire life. So yield to Him. The other thing, the Bible says, if you ask Jesus for an egg, He's not going to give you a serpent. If you're asking God to birth something in you, you're not going to get something demonic or counterfeit. So eliminate the fear that you may not get the real McCoy. You didn't think that when you asked Jesus to come in your heart, you didn't think you were going to get an antichrist and be surprised the next night. You knew that Jesus was watching over that transaction. You are going to receive the real deal right now as well. So let's pray. All of us together, say this with me. Everyone praying, say this with me. Say, Lord Jesus, as you are my Savior, I ask you to be my baptizer, to baptize me with the Holy Spirit and with fire. So as your Spirit comes upon me, hands are laid on me, I will praise you in other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance. And I receive a fresh endowment of power, fresh boldness, signs and wonders to be a more effective witness for you in the marketplace. Lord, fill me. Come on, Lord, fill me now. Okay. Prayer team, as you feel led, begin to pray and step out. Worship team, Isaiah 44:3, He pours water on them that are thirsty. Begin to release thirst right now towards the throne. Woo! Come on. Fresh baptism. Say, fill, be filled with the Holy Ghost. Begin to tell the Lord you love Him. Begin to release just a worship towards the Lord, and God will take the water of your known language and turn it into the wine of a new language. Lord, I love you. Begin to tell the Lord you love Him. Don't stand around. Begin to worship. Begin to worship Him. And all of a sudden, you're no longer speaking English. You'll shift like you shift a gear in your car. And all of a sudden, a language, it comes out at first. It sounds weird. It feels like a baby coming out of the womb and it doesn't come out going, hi, mom, hi, dad. But I dare you, let that language be unleashed. Worship Him with your heart. Come on, as the worship team sings, there's fire falling. Spirit of God is falling. Begin to thirst, hunger. keep pressing in. Step forward. There's still prayer team members ready. You draw on God. I dare you to come hungry. I dare you to come thirsty. The trigger for every outpouring is thirst. Isaiah 44:3, I will pour water on them that are thirsty. Come thirsty. Thirsty for the rain of God as they sing this. Press into God again. More of Jesus. Begin to press into the Lord, those of you that remain. And right now, I just feel like the Lord, you have got God's attention. Close your eyes and begin to let Jesus know you want more of him. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is not an it. He's not power that you use. He's the divine person of the Trinity. It's about relationship. Begin to press in and say, Holy Spirit, I want more. Begin to say to the Holy Spirit, I surrender more of me. I want more of you to inhabit more of me. Come on, just press in a little bit longer. I dare you to go at least 5 more minutes with some intensity, with some steam. I dare you. Come on, let's just do a little bit longer. I'm